Please rise if you're comfortable doing so as we sing our first two songs. God has provided all that we need and more. Let's share with God now what we offer to Him. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. God of eternal presence, where you are, there creation lies. For you are the mind that conceived the universe and everything within it. You are the energy that sustains it and moves it through time. You are the presence that defines all reality, for without you nothing can exist. As we gather before you, we realize that we are not calling you into existence. We realize that we are making ourselves aware of your presence with you, that because we live and breathe and move, you must be at work, and you must be here. And so we recognize that we are on holy ground, not just because we are in a church, but because wherever you are, there we find your holiness. And since you are everywhere, we must respond with the reverence and awe you deserve. God of eternal work, only because you work within creation do the stars and planets move. Does time progress forward or life exist? Only through your efforts do creatures and plants have life. Only because you are at work within us do we have a sense of purpose and a part in the work required within your creation. And so we realize that you have given us holy hands, hands that can glorify you during this time of worship, hands that can accomplish heavenly deeds through earthly means. God of the eternal word, yours is the word by which you called creation into being, the word that you spoke through us, to us through Jesus Christ, the word that is revealed in your holy scriptures, and the word that transforms us and makes our own lips holy. Here, as we speak to you our own words, we ask that you hear our words of confession spoken in our silent prayers. Speak to us through your own holy lips, your words of forgiveness and redemption, as we listen in silence for your holy word. Hear us as we speak to you our own words of thanksgiving and praise, offered in our silent prayers. Hear us as we speak about how, as we ask about how we can best fulfill your will for us, shared in our silent prayers. Hear us as we ask your, as we voice our concern for our neighbors, friends, and family, offered in our silent prayers. Hear us as we pray for your creation and everything living within it, shared in our silent prayers. Eternal, ever-present God, we have gathered in your presence and now stand upon the ground you have made holy. Creator God, we acknowledge that we are here by the work of your hands and seek to do your work for us with the holy hands you have given us. Living God, who speaks to us through your living word, we ask in Jesus that you hear our holy prayers offered with the holy lips you have granted us. Amen. Friends, let's share the prayer that Jesus first taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory,
forever and ever. Amen.
I believe Phyllis Brody is our reader this morning.
Our first reading today is from Corinthians chapter 12, verses 12 to 20. You can easily enough see how this kind of thing works by looking no further than your own body. Your body has many parts, limbs, organs, cells, but no matter how many parts you can name, you're still one body. It's exactly the same with Christ. By means of his spirit, we all said goodbye to our partial and piecemeal lives. We each used to independently call our own shots, but then we entered into a larger and integrated life in which he has the final say in everything. This is what we proclaimed in word and action when we were baptized. Each of us is now a part of his resurrection body, refreshed and sustained at one fountain, his spirit, where we all come to drink. The old labels we once used to identify ourselves, labels like Jew or Greek, slave or free, are no longer useful. We need something larger, more comprehensive. I want you to think about how all this makes you more significant, not less. A body isn't just a single part blown up into something huge. It's all the different but similar parts arranged and functioning together. And our second reading is from Romans 8, verses 14 to 17. God's Spirit beckons, there are things to do and places to go. This resurrection life you receive from God is not a timid, grave-tending life. It's adventurously expectant, greeting God with a childlike, "What's next, Papa?" God's Spirit touches our spirits and confirms who we really are. We know who He is, and we know who we are, Father and children, and we know we are going to get what's coming to us, an unbelievable inheritance. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. If we go through the hard times with him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with him.
We're going to sing.
Thank you.
And our next reading is from John 15, verses 12 to 15. I told you these things for a purpose, that my joy might be your joy, and your joy wholly mature. This is my command. Love one another the way I loved you. This is the very best way to love. Put your life on the line for your friends. You are my friends when you do the things I command you. I'm no longer calling your servants, because servants don't understand what their master is thinking and planning. No, I've named you friends, because I let you in on everything I've heard from the Father.
I'm going to need a fresh battery, Pete. See, red light's on. It's bad. Start to mark yourself. Hi there. Part of my ministry is providing pastoral care for folks. So I often find myself in nursing homes. And one of the things that you realize very, very quickly about pastoral care in a nursing home is that 90% of the needs of human beings are taken care of very well in nursing homes. The residents are well fed, they are taken care of from a medical perspective, their mobility is compensated for, you know, they've got lifts to get people out of bed or walkers. They encourage people to move about and to exercise. They provide entertainment. They provide everything except for the one thing that is most needed by pretty much every human being, and that is companionship. It's not a shortcoming of the institutions by any means. It's just a nature, or just the fact that when you've got 60, 70 residents, and you've got maybe 20 or 25 staff people, not every resident can have a friend or companion in those people that are providing all of the other needs. And really, that's not their job. The job of the nurses, doctors, the personal care workers, everybody else is to provide the basic needs for those folks. The rest of it, that important companionship part, that sense of belonging, has to come from family, from pastoral care folks like myself, from their friends, from their community, from whatever clubs or churches they belong to. But the patients that thrive are the ones that feel that sense of belonging. Now, there is, of course, a sense of community from the caregivers. The caregivers go to extraordinary lengths to go above and beyond the call of duty. And I can't tell you how many times I have gone into a nursing home to see a new patient or a new resident for the first time. You know, Mrs. McGillicuddy just moved in on Monday, and I get a chance finally to see her on Friday. And I go in on Friday to see Miss McGillicuddy, and I go to the front desk and I say, I'm looking for a new patient, Miss McGillicuddy. And 99% of the time, at least one of the caregivers will say, oh yeah, she's down in room 37B, and she's in a really good mood today. So within a few days, they have already established a relationship and know who that person is. So the caregivers, I believe, go above and beyond the call of duty in providing this sense of community, even though it's not necessarily part of their job description. Now, some folks who have been working there professionally might argue that it is, but it's one of those things that you just can't do everything. But that sense of belonging, that need for community, is so evident when you're in there frequently and you see the same people who don't have any family, who for whatever reason, there's some people who are tough to be with, and so they're disconnected. They don't have a community even within that small community. They don't have that sense of belonging, and they are the least happy or the least likely to thrive and to be there very long. One of the sad realities. But there in that place, you see how important a sense of belonging is, a sense of community, a sense of being part of something beyond yourself is. Because all the other needs are provided for. Not one patient ever says, or not one resident ever says, I'm hungry, or don't get enough rest, or I can't get to the bathroom because I can't get out of bed. All of those needs are taken care of. But it's that companionship that makes all the difference. And we live in kind of a fractured world. We live in a place where we form community. We try to find a sense of belonging, but it's kind of scattered. It's kind of all over the map. Some folks find their sense of belonging within their family. Some folks find a sense of belonging within their workplace. Some within their community activities, some within hobbies or sports. Some folks find them in bars at weekends or in the evenings. So there's a common thread of people seeking a connectedness, but how we find that connectedness is varied, is different for each and every one of us. And what ends up happening is we see ourselves fractured. We see a world, and we can see this now that the internet brings us so much more news so readily. We can see how fractured we are as communities, as people, because we hear the same things happening throughout the world in different places that all speak to this lack of a sense of belonging, to folks who feel ostracized or left out, to entire communities that are at war with one another, to the disagreements that we have, to all of this that I think comes from the fact that we are really disconnected from one another. So we're talking about why we need to bother with God. And today I want to talk about how God provides a sense of belonging, provides a broader sense of community, a broader sense of unity, and a broader sense of oneness. So today we started off with a passage from a letter to the Corinthian people, and Paul was talking about the fracturing of these people. These people couldn't agree on anything. The letter was written in order to draw them together and to explain how to be Christians, how to understand their relationship with one another through Christ. And he uses a powerful image of a body, something that we are all intimately familiar with, right? You know your own bodies, and you know how there are different parts, and you realize that each part has to work in concert and together, and yet each part is unique, right? Your hand is very different from your eye, which is very different from your ear, which is very different from your belly button, which is very different from your foot. And yet each part works together with the other ones, despite the fact that it's different and unique. And Paul uses this image in order to draw us into thinking about this idea of community. But he doesn't say it to us as individuals. You know, he's not speaking to us to think, oh, isn't this marvelous? God gave me this great body, and I've got to make sure everything works together. And so then we start dancing so we can make our eyes work together with our hands and our arms and our feet. And I'm not going to do it for you, thank you, no, because you don't want to see how this works together. But it's not about us. The reason he's talking about a body is in a larger sense, in this sense that we have all been created by God as a unity, as almost a single entity. One of the reasons we human beings pretty much all look alike, you know, we've got a head and shoulders and arms, I mean, the basic physical form, is not just that we resemble God in these varied images, but also that we recognize in each other that we're the same thing. That we can see in each other this common image, this commonality. So we recognize in neighbors and friends, family members, community members, oh yeah, you know, she's got two arms just like I do, or two legs, or a couple of eyeballs, or a head, or hair. Well, some people have more hair. But, you know, we recognize this commonality. We see in each other ourselves and the other. But the biggest idea of this is that we see in our commonality the image of God. Now, you might have been around a little in your lives. Has anybody ever been outside of Chatham? Anybody ever been to downtown Chatham? You might notice that not everybody is exactly like you. So some folks might have a missing finger or two or a missing limb. Some folks might have more hair than you or less. Some folks might be really skinny. Some folks might be really round. There are different colors. There are different sexual orientations. There are different religious backgrounds. And yet, when you boil it down, we're all still the image of God. So when we take Paul's words seriously, we realize that the reason we have these similar bodies is because we belong to God. Each and every one of us belongs to God. That's our first and foremost relationship. That's our historical first companion in the garden. Who was there? Adam, Eve, and God. So that Trinity expresses our sense of belonging. We do indeed belong to God. Now, in case you missed the point, I'm going to repeat myself. We belong to God. What's my point? The one we belong to is God. Do you get that? However, because of what happened in the garden, we broke that relationship. And when we broke that relationship, we became blind to our belongingness. We became blind to the fact that our bodies are God's body, that our image is the one that reflects God. So whoever we are, wherever we are, did I say this before, that we belong to God? Did I mention that? But we have to remember that. Because when we remember it, when we remember that we are God's, then an interesting thing happens. We start to see not individuals that are separate or that are really different, but what we start to see is the common body with the different parts. That's what starts coming into play. As we start to recognize, not Miss McGillicuddy or Mr. Smith or Mrs. Jones, we start to recognize, Miss McGillicuddy is always knitting for people.
She's a provider. She always does stuff for folks. She's like a hand working God's wonders. Or we see Mr. Smith. Mr. Smith has a unique wisdom about him. And whenever you talk to Mr. Smith, you feel smarter. You've learned something. So Mr. Smith reflects God's wisdom. He's the brain. Or Ms. Jones. Ms. Jones is the one that always makes things clear. You go in and you're wondering what to do next, and Ms. Jones has a way of either pointing you in the right direction or saying, well, why don't you just take a break for a minute? Why don't you stop trying to do and sit? Because maybe that's the right direction. So she's the kind of voice that speaks the truth to you, and you recognize that we're all different parts of the same body. But without that sense of God, without realizing that we are the image of God, we don't realize that we belong to a larger whole. We get stuck thinking that our family is the single most important thing, or that our work community is what drives us, or that our clubs or sports or hobbies are the things that matter. And when we start to do that, then we start to divide and to separate, or we start to identify, well, I happen to be an Italian Canadian, so I really like Italian Canadians myself, even though I married a woman from Great Britain, and not only that, but she's also Irish, Scottish, Welsh, and English. So a purebred, I married this Canadian mutt. But we start to form those divisions. And if you get to Italy, if you ever spend any time in Italy, you have to be in the north because the south is terrible. Unless you're from the south, in which case you have to spend time in the south because the north is terrible. But we start to form these divisions because we're so localized, we're so self-centered, we forget whose we really are. But here's the thing. Paul tells us that we're one body. But we still have this brokenness issue that's driving us. So Paul also reminds us that through Jesus we have that relationship fixed and restored. In fact, he calls it a resurrection body. He calls it a resurrection body because through Jesus, we're brought back to life. And that life actually means that we are restored in relationship to God. You see, without God, not only do we lose who we are, but we are in effect dead inside. Without God's presence in our lives, without God's influence, without knowing we belong to God, we are, in effect, just living corpses. We think, we walk, but we have no life within us. So we have to be back in touch, back connected with God, and that's provided through Jesus. But Jesus does another thing. Not only does he reconnect us with God, Jesus is the ultimate one who draws us into this sense of belonging. When he talked to his disciples, in John's Gospel, he's talking to his disciples. And the role of disciple is very specific. Okay, a disciple is a follower. And Jesus constantly invites people to follow him. But in our reading today, we hear Jesus change that relationship from follower, from almost a kind of employee. He changes that relationship to friend. And by changing that relationship to friend, he no longer expects us to follow. We're no longer employees. We're no longer folks who are there because we have jobs to do. As a friend, we're drawn into the most intimate circle of our relationship with him. But then he goes on And he calls us children, brothers and sisters to himself. And that draws that circle complete. We have a new life, and we have a new relationship. We understand ourselves as God's children. So that's the ultimate sense of belonging. That's the ultimate sense of connection. That's the ultimate sense of place, because now, where we are is not simply on earth, but we're also in God's heart. I've used that thought before, right? Where we are in God's heart. We belong there. Now, if we have this sense of belonging in God, and there's always this idea of a looking up in order to understand where we belong when we look down. If we just look out this way, then all we see is a bunch of individuals. But if we look up from God's perspective, we realize that really we're just one body. And that body exists throughout the earth. That's the amazing thing. Now, the internet tells us a lot of bad stuff is happening. But what it's also doing is it's drawing us together as one. It's making us realize, hey, you know what? The folks in Japan face the same issues of depression and struggle and isolation as we do. You know what? If you look at Sweden and you look at the way their society works, they have a lot of the issues that we have, but they've also started to solve a lot of them. So we begin to realize our commonality. We begin to realize that we are indeed one humanity. And we have so much more in common than we have that isolates us. I mean, I know that when I started to realize what English food was really like, I was not too impressed because I grew up in an Italian household and you know, we have sauces and a lot of tomatoes. And my mom took real pride in cooking. And then I started to realize, well, there's other cuisines out there. And we start to integrate them. Now, how many of you have ever had Italian food? Now, you realize you're living in Chatham, right? Southwestern Ontario. How many of you have had Chinese food? You realize you're living in Chatham. How many of you have had Indian food? You realize you're living in Chatham. How many of you have had shawarma? You realize you're living in Chatham? In Chatham? Chatham. In Chatham? We all eat. Charming child. Charming. We all eat, right? I mean, the foods might be a little bit different depending on where you grow up. The best lemons I ever had were from southern Italy. A northern Italian going to southern Italy. But we all eat. How many of you have ever heard an opera? That's Italian music, did you know that? Yeah, he didn't write very well. Not nearly as well as Verdi. How many of you have heard a polka? That's German music. Do I need to go on? The varieties that we have out there, we have music in common throughout the world. It might sound a little different. Different instruments, different tonalities, but we all have music in common. How many of you have ever danced a waltz? How many of you have ever danced a jig?
Sure.
No. A few. Well, we all dance. The stuff that unites us as a humanity is far greater than the stuff that divides us. And if you look closely, if you start to think about our societies, what divides us is the stuff that we invented. Nations, languages, theologies. These are the things that divide us because we are separate from our God. But when we get close to God, we get not only a sense of belonging in our Creator, but we also realize that we have a greater sense of belonging with our neighbors, within our community, within our world. As a church, and I keep coming back to this image that we don't have windows. Choir has windows. Or praise team has windows. We can actually see outside. And it's a really good thing that there's a blind on that window, because I'm always looking outside the other window, watching the fellow other trees there. But sometimes it's easy for us to think that we are isolated here, that this is all there is to the world, because we've got four walls, ceilings, floor. But we belong to a larger community. We belong here. How many of you know your neighbors? You know your neighbors, so that's part of a community, right? We know we belong to a part of a community, but then the struggle question comes out. How much of our community knows that we are here? That St. James Presbyterian Church is at work within the community. That's our balance. That's where we need to work as a community, talking with one another to figure out how it is that our community knows that we're here. And for us to define how we can include our community so that our sense of belonging isn't just within these walls, but our sense of belonging is in a larger realm, with the neighbors that are just behind us, with the school that's across the street, with the college that's down over there, with the nursing homes that are on Sandy Street and beyond. How do we create that sense of belonging that says our community belongs to us just as much as we belong to our community? So that's our struggle, that's our challenge. We have a sense of belonging with God. How do we invite others to realize that they too belong to our wonderful, loving Creator? How do we create that sense of belonging that unites all humanity with the one that made them? Amen. Let's bow our heads together in prayer. Loving God, when we take a look through our own eyes, we see people of color who aren't quite like us. We see different nations who eat strange foods. We hear voices and music that are unusual and not at all like the way that we speak or hear songs. We feel ourselves torn in different directions as we have traditions and cultures that aren't quite like those of the folks around us. And when we look from our level, that's all that we see. When we listen through our own ears, that's all that we hear. When we feel with our own senses, that's all that we perceive. And yet we know that we belong to you, that you made us in your image. To be made in your image, we are all the same in heart. We are all your children, brothers and sisters to Christ. So we ask that you give us your eyes and your ears, your wisdom, so that we can better understand one another, so that we can have a sense of belonging, not just to you, but with our neighbors, with our friends, even with strangers, so that across the globe we might come together, work as one for the common goodness, work as one to maintain our planet in its beauty, work as one to ensure that we are all fed, watered, and nourished, work as one to ensure that we have good and decent work, work as one to see that we are all clothed and provided for, work as one to see that we are all loved and celebrated and appreciated for who we are. Loving God, help us to take our sense of belonging to you and to spread spread it to others, to share it, to help them come to life in you as well. Help us as your church, St. James Presbyterian Church here in Chatham, to thrive and to flourish and to grow in a way that becomes seamless with our community so that they identify with us just as we identify with them. Above all, God, help us to take that sense of belonging and to celebrate it, to thrive within you so that we might be the best that you made us to be and so that we might be a true reflection of you. In Jesus' name we offer these words. Amen. Please rise for our benediction. Now may the love of God, the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, and the presence of Jesus himself be with you this day and forevermore. And together we say, Amen. Amen.